It's my great pleasure to welcome to a Boundary 2 event for the first time, and also to Pittsburgh for the first time, Professor Annie McClanahan. Professor McClanahan took her PhD at Berkeley in 2010, and she's now assistant professor of English at UCal Irvine, one of those deeply neoliberal sponsored theory collectives that Christian was identifying earlier as the offshoot of some pernicious funding group.
Maybe.
People say. I'm sure it's on Twitter by now. On graduation from Berkeley, she became a postdoctoral fellow in the Humanities Center at Harvard, and before taking up her position at Irvine, took additional fellowships from the Institute for Research in the Humanities at Madison, the Society for the Humanities at Cornell, and the Center for 21st Century Studies at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. She's currently researching the cultural history of microeconomics, and I quote from her. She's researching the cultural history of microeconomics, quote, taking the measure of microeconomics' influence on cultural production and critical theory, end quote, as the basis of a new book. A new paper entitled On Becoming Non-Economic, Human Capital Theory and Wendy Brown's Undoing the Demos, appeared in Theory and Event in 2016. Several of her earlier papers tie together problems of debt, the rise of finance capital, and neoliberalism's investment in crises to show that finance capital has its own philosophy of history and acts intentionally within society and culture. In her first book entitled, I think I've mistyped this. It can't be Dean Pledges.
Dean Pledges is all over.
Dead Pledges, subtitled Debt Crisis and 21st Century Culture, published by Stanford last year. Professor McClanahan gives us a deep theorizing of debt, as well as detailed yet speculative analyses of how debt and the structures that employ and profit from it organize new reaches of life across areas not traditionally part of consumer culture. Despite its materiality and near universality, debt remains extremely hard to conceptualize. Professor McClanahan shows that, as a result, the ubiquitous yet elusive social form debt might be understood, and I quote again, understood best by looking at how our culture has sought to represent it. Today, Professor McClanahan will speak to us on the topic, Serious Crises, Rethinking the Neoliberal Subject. Please welcome her.
Thank you so much, Paul, and thanks to all of you for having me and for being here. I am very nervous. So I'm using this PowerPoint. I was just actually saying this to David. I usually only use PowerPoint when I have images, and it's not just for quotes, but the first half of this paper is kind of, discourse analysis of discourse analysis. So there's a sort of rapid fire quotation method that characterizes the first half of the paper. So hence the PowerPoint to sort of make it a bit clear, and so I don't have to worry so much about making sure I say quote unquote all the time. I speak here today as a massive fan of Philip Mirowski. In More Heat Than Light, Against Mechanism and Machine Dreams, he models the kind of real, rigorous interdisciplinarity that most of us can only dream of. In his work, unlike that of just about anyone else I can think of, we see the realization of what Deleuze described as disciplinary interference, the, quote, most elusive form of interdisciplinary thought, that which forces, quote, forces a practice to confront its own unthought. That he does so, Mirowski does so with enough vivid prose and satiric humor to make these dense works of intellectual history read with almost novelistic verve is almost too impressive to contemplate. I had not, however, read Mirowski's work on neoliberalism prior to my invitation here, and for this opportunity, too, I'm grateful. His contributions to the conversation on this vexed and vexing term have already been well summarized, so let me say simply that what strikes me the most is the way that, in the Montpelerin volume especially, he has given us a sense of neoliberalism as a consciously constructed doctrine, the product of what we might thus call inorganic intellectuals. a quote, elaborate transnational institutional project, he observes, the MPS was convened to, quote, construct a new version of liberalism whose starting point was, quote, the admission that its political program must be constructed and will not come about naturally in the absence of concerted effort. His theory of the Chicago School, then, offers a much-needed provincialization of the high-minded ideas of neoliberalism, a tale more about faculty snarking and backroom deals than about big philosophical ideas like the price system or laissez-faire markets. So far, so good. And yet I admit that I have a certain hesitation here. My hesitation has nothing to do with the mastery of this account, nor with the ways it allows us to see the important role played by this thought collective and their thoughts in the early Montpelerin moment and also in our own moment. My hesitation comes when the doctrine or philosophy of neoliberalism, as Mirowski described it, is wrangled, largely by other critics, into the shape of a historical period. And when commitment to that periodization eclipses other possibilities, particularly the one this engram suggests. For me, at least, describing something as a period implies, minimally, two conditions. The first condition is that the force in question, here the doctrine of neoliberalism constructed by the MPS starting in the 1940s, must become, at a certain moment, for most accounts of neoliberalism as a period, that moment occurs sometime around the 1980s, the primary characteristic of that moment. So a certain set of ideas or a certain set of conditions become the sort of primary characteristic of a moment, at a moment. The second condition is that the force thus identified is the primary cause of most of the other related and or adjacent changes in that moment. While neoliberalism may arguably meet the first of these criteria, I'm slightly less convinced it meets the second. If it did, we would have to position this ideology as the primary cause of related economic changes like, say, wage stagnation or the rise of finance, rather than as the most ready-to-hand political alibi for them. I'm skeptical of that claim. That is, as if it's not been clear already, I come to you as a largely unrepentant, vulgar Marxist, sharing Engels's view that, quote, the final causes of all social changes are to be sought not in men's brains, but in the economies of each epoch. But no matter what our theory of the power of men's brains, we might at least agree that the typical use of neoliberalism as the name for a historical period beginning, in the US at least, in the Reagan-Thatcher 80s, or the Clinton 90s, or even sometimes the Bush 2000s, leaves decisively unanswered the question of why it doesn't begin in the early 1940s, when Hayek wrote Road to Serfdom, or the late 1940s, when the MPS was founded, or even the early 1960s, when Friedman's Capitalism and Freedom attempted to popularize Hayek's arguments. The gap between the construction of this ideology and its ultimate hegemony might not raise serious questions about cause versus effect, were it not for the fact that if you read the Montpelerin position statements or Hayek's work, you see clearly the rather startling shared belief that an imminent worldwide turn towards socialism and away from liberal capitalism was more likely than not. That is to say, MPS neoliberalism had state socialism and central planning as both its political target and its intellectual context, which should then at least make us wonder why these ideas didn't become important or dominant in the way that they are until the 1980s or 90s. That is, if neoliberalism was born as an ideology positioned explicitly against a perceived socialist threat, what does it mean that it triumphed at precisely the moment that threat had effectively vanished? Given this, I would suggest that the reason for the triumph of neoliberal ideas has to be found in some set of forces outside the ideas themselves. Only in this way can we understand what purpose those ideas, having been wrenched rather violently from their original context, might serve in a different context. I might rather humbly offer this chart, the falling world rate of profit, or if you want to get a little smaller scale, this chart, this division between service work and manufacturing in the United States, as good candidates for that other purpose. But you don't, thankfully, have to be an economic determinist to agree with me that unless we want to subscribe to a kind of conspiracy theory of history, relating the ideas constructed by intellectuals in a Swiss chalet in the 1940s and the everyday ideology of contemporary 21st century subjects, it at least raises some methodological problems. How, we must inquire, can we answer the question Max Weber famously phrased as, quote, the manner in which ideas become effective forces in history? Given that this particular set of ideas emerged not, as in Weber's account of Protestantism, from the bottom up, but rather from the top down, how, forgive me in advance here, did they trickle down, even to the subjects subjects least likely to benefit from them? The task of explaining how neoliberalism morphed from the intellectual project of a scattered few intellectuals writing amidst and against the socialist threat into the defining feature of 21st century life, how it became, in the term many critics deploy, a kind of Gramscian common sense, has thus been of urgent importance to contemporary theorists of neoliberalism. This is so true, indeed, that if anything, we have increasingly tended to describe neoliberalism not as a set of specific policies or historical practices, but instead as a kind of structure of feeling. This tendency to describe neoliberalism as a feeling might be due to the fact that in the work of Michel Foucault, arguably the most influential theorist of neoliberalism, we have none of the kinds of institutions or material apparatuses that, in Foucault's earlier work, transformed ideas and discourses into material and historical condition. Absent sites like the confessional, the panopticon, the psychic ward, and absent too the slave ships and factories and assembly lines that defined and made legible the modes of accumulation of past historical epochs, neoliberalism has tended, especially in cultural and literary theory, to be treated primarily as, in David Harvey's terms, a quote, conceptual apparatus that appeals to our intuitions and instincts, to our values and desires, or as what Wendy Brown describes as a form of soft rather than hard power, or, as Jason Reed puts it, a system that operates on interests, desires, and aspirations of individuals, not by marking the body, but by acting on the conditions of actions, or, in Mauricio Lazzarato's essay on the neoliberal condition, as a mode of power that relies not on punishment or coercion, but rather on the production and control of subjectivity. Despite this emphasis on language, consciousness, and subjectivity, however, if you were trying to understand what precisely is meant by the neoliberal subject in contemporary cultural theory, you might well find yourself confused. On the one hand, we have tended to describe the neoliberal subject as the victim of an attenuation, the reduction of human individuality into nothing more than homo economicus or human capital. Lazzarato thus argues that individuals become individuals, samples, data, markets, or banks, while Henri Giroux tells us that critical analysis, moral judgments, and social responsibility have given way to the desire to accumulate profits at almost any cost, and Michel Fayre claims that, quote, love, religion, and culture are reduced to a mere calculus of interest. All of these accounts suggest, in short, that all the complexity and richness of the human subject has been evacuated, replaced by calculation of loss and gain, risk and reward. In Brown's account, indeed, the neoliberal subject has lost her very soul. And yet, on the other hand, and here I'm thinking particularly of literary studies, we are told that the neoliberal individual is more individually than ever. Neoliberalism is about, quote, the enrichment of the self. It, quote, focuses on the individual as a discrete actor. It is concerned with the, quote, fully realized self that, quote, grows and develops through connections with others. It is, quote, committed to the value of self-expression. Those quotes are Rachel Greenwood Smith, Jeff Williams, and Jane Elliott. Neoliberalism's literary correlatives are, quote, vividly personal and intimately addressed lyric poems, or they are, quote, moving stories of struggle in which we are asked to care deeply about, quote, the development of the writer's own voice, or they are, quote, multiculturalist historical novels about past historical trauma, or they are literary paeans to, quote, an almost ecstatic bubbling up of ferocious individualism, or to a kind of, quote, cosmopolitan conviviality. That's Jennifer Ashton, Walter Ben Michaels, Anish Shivani, and Emily Johansson. I will later sort of shorthand that side of that position to as the Walter Ben Michaels position, just for ease. metonymy. In short, we find neoliberalism described both as the annulment and the triumph of individuals, both the reduction of specificity and the celebration of difference, both cold calculation and the effective turn. Hence, too, neoliberalism is both student debt, which doesn't care enough about students, and trigger warnings, which care too much. It's welfare reform and the Google cafeteria. It's data tracking and drone warfare and subprime mortgages, but it's also Instagram and cognitive behavioral therapy and 401ks. I am not quite saying that theories of neoliberal subjectivity are unaware of these contradictions. In fact, cultural and literary theories of the neoliberal subject quite commonly offer two figures to explain the relationship between a neoliberal reduction of the individual to money and the equally neoliberal celebration of individual richness. The first of these is human capital, which describes the means through which neoliberalism draws institutions and life worlds formerly separate from the profit motive into its grasp. As Michel Fayer puts it, quote, "Domains such as health, education, and culture are no longer conceived as external conditions. They instead become sectors of the valorizing of the self understood as capital." For Foucault, likewise, human capital marks, quote, "the generalization of the economic form of market throughout the social body and including the whole of the social system." Put simply, human capital indicates the extent to which a variety of sites undergo the process of becoming economic. The second figure typically proffered by theories of neoliberalism, one intimately related to the idea of human capital, is what Foucault terms the entrepreneur of the self. If human capital is used to describe the set of transformations within the social body, then the entrepreneur describes the kind of individual those transformations presuppose, target, and produce. Calculating every action according to a calculus of investment, the entrepreneur is, as Brown puts it, quote, "conceived as the manager of a portfolio, receiving the dividends of conducts pertaining to all the aspects of his or her life." Robbed of her non-instrumentalized humanity, the neoliberal subject is thus compensated by being imaginatively rich in human capital. Tasked with sole responsibility for her own subsistence, she is recast as a canny entrepreneur free to speculatively invest in herself. This sense of the compensatory quality of neoliberal ideology runs throughout theories of neoliberal subjectivity. From Giroux's claim that, quote, neoliberalism's best trick is to persuade individuals that they should imagine themselves as solitary agents who can and must live the good life promised by capitalist culture, to Lauren Berlant's influential idea of cruel optimism. In a world in which, as Fayer puts it, all conduct is now economic conduct, the cruelly optimistic entrepreneurial subject can at least still conceive of herself as manager of a portfolio of conducts, capital, and choices. Thus, Jason Reed writes of the imagined entrepreneur who, quote, "treats every action from taking courses on a new computer software application to having their teeth whitened as an investment." In the remainder of this talk, then, I want to think about these two categories a bit. I begin with the idea of human capital, especially with its frequent application to the university. I want to think a bit more about the way in which the university has become a privileged site for the critique of neoliberalism, and to wonder what such characterizations risk missing about the university and, by extension, about the other reproductive domains treated as formerly exterior to capitalist reason. I go on to explore the idea of the entrepreneurial subject in order to argue that by characterizing neoliberalism through the experience of a specific kind of entrepreneurial subject, the subject, not to put too fine a point on it, who might study new consumer software applications or whiten her teeth, who worries about the quality of his kid's private school and seeks out grants to burnish his CV, we miss the possibility that neoliberalism is not the wholesale becoming economic of the formerly non-economic, but rather the introduction of economic exigencies into the lives of a group once protected from them. Here then, I want to suggest some other sites beyond the university where we might turn to answer the question, who is the historical subject of the present? And in so doing, to argue that in these sites, we find neither soft power, nor entrepreneurial subjectivity, nor human capital, but rather violence, waste, and social death. We also find, I think, something rather different from Berlant's notion of cruel optimism, and to the extent to which this essay itself indicates any optimism, it rests there. Okay, so first part, human capital and the becoming economic of the university. Let me begin then with human capital, and specifically with its relationship to the university. If recent Foucauldian theories of neoliberal subjectivity do not have anything quite so obvious as a panopticon to ground their analysis, they do still have a common site, namely the university. Thus, Brown, most influentially, argues that the post-war university of the mid-century United States, produced in part by the Servicemen's Readjustment Act, or GI Bill, of 1944, was, quote, "education for the many, destining them for more than economic servitude or mere survival." The mid-century university enabled by the GI Bill, argues Henry Giroux, quote, believed education was more important than job training. Whoops, didn't put that one up there. Oh well. This period, writes William Dershowitz, was thus, quote, the heyday of the public university and also of the liberal arts. Quote, if those middle and working class kids were going to college just to get a better job, he muses, why did so many of them major in English? Because they wanted to learn, think, reflect, and grow. For all these thinkers, these halcyon days of non-instrumental humanist education for all changed with the neoliberalization of the university sometime during the last few decades. Quote, since Thatcher, Terry Eagleton opines, the role of the neoliberal university has been to service the status quo. Human capital theory plays a particularly strong role in these accounts. Thus, Giroux argues that higher education is now, quote, justified through an appeal to fulfilling the need for human capital, while Brown describes human capital theory as, quote, reducing the development of the person to the capacity for economic advantage. The implication here is that prior to the neoliberal era, the university had a mission separable from the needs of the labor market and was thus completely willing to let English majors do their non-remunerative thing simply because it believed in the intrinsic value of such study. And it suggests in turn that this has changed in recent decades because of the introduction of human capital as the dominant rationality of the university. That now, unlike before, the university is primarily involved in the enhancement of students' human capital as future employees. And yet, in fact, the development of human capital theory was quite precisely concomitant with the passage of the GI Bill in the mid-1940s. The first use of the term human capital 2 decades before Becker's book in 1965 appeared in an influential speech given in 1941 by the Chicago School economist Frank Knight. It appeared soon after in the work of Milton Friedman and Alan Fisher. Fisher and Knight were concerned about the political and economic effects of the high levels of unemployment seen during the Depression, while Friedman, who would go on in the 1950s to create what would become the modern federal student loan program under the auspices of the National Education Defense Act, intended to provide the country with more highly educated defense personnel. Friedman was specifically worried about the possible correlation between the education levels of American citizens and the relative strength of the American empire. For all these theorists, then, education policy had to also be economic policy, and the need for higher rates of college education were immediately yoked to the changing needs of the labor market. These were precisely the same arguments and anxieties that led to the creation of the GI Bill, whose passage was aided by a Labor Department projection that post-war unemployment rates might hit 25%, because of precisely the neglect of workforce education that Knight and Fisher had been worried about when they developed the idea of human capital in the first place. It's thus not surprising that Becker began his hugely influential dissertation project in the mid-1950s, precisely as the early cohorts of the GI Bill were entering the workforce and the bill's economic impact was becoming visible and studyable. Both human capital theory and the GI Bill University, in short, focused on increasing national employment and on the relationship between individual income and education. And yet the mid-century need to enlarge and modernize the U.S. workforce was not itself merely a set of ideological beliefs. Stimulated by the end of the war, the U.S. economy required, and could pay, more credentialed professional workers than ever before. As a result, although the education premium, that's the lifetime, the increase in lifetime earnings that accrues to people with a college degree, although the education premium had shrunk between the 19-teens and the early 1940s, so in between the teens and the 40s, the difference between educated and uneducated workers in terms of lifetime pay was relatively small. It rebounded strongly in the 1950s, so then it widened, so that because you need more educated workers, basically, and they're paid more. Because the resulting wage gains applied only to workers in certain sectors, however, this education premium was not obtained by everyone. State investment in higher education tends to shrink one kind of income inequality between the middle class and the rich, but to grow another between unskilled and skilled workers. Moreover, as historian Ira Katznelson has demonstrated, the GI Bill was deliberately designed and written to accommodate Jim Crow segregation, which meant that in addition to enhancing the gap between skilled and unskilled workers, it also racialized it, by ensuring that African Americans were largely excluded from specialized education and from new middle class careers. Far from being a betrayal of the vision of the post-war university, in other words, theories of human capital were that university's condition of possibility. The point here is not that the post-war university was as ideological as the contemporary university, nor is the point that nothing has changed in the contemporary university. Rather, the point is that both the distasteful rhetoric of human capital theory and the salutary rhetoric of the democratic public university are the inextricable effects of economic conditions. When we argue that neoliberalism marks the becoming economic of formerly non-economic spheres of existence, we miss the possibility that under capitalism there is nothing more economic than marking a particular site as non-economic. That is why an insistence on the real productivity of spaces seemingly autonomous from capitalism has long been a key part of the political claims of excluded subjects, from the wages for housework movement of the 1970s to the unionization of graduate student employees in the 1990s and 2000s. Likewise, in the U.S. university in the second half of the 20th century was decisively economic in both its mission and its structure. And its primarily economic function was no less real for being disavowed by the very knowledge workers who were its beneficiaries, by the new professionals who were themselves escaping economic servitude by capitalizing on their economic success. The reality of the post-war university's economic purpose could coexist with the paradoxical insistence that the university was non-economic precisely because the university's economic stimulus worked, or, more specifically, because the university's graduates worked. That is, there was no contradiction between going to college to get a job and deciding to major in English, since college-educated English majors were able to get good middle and upper middle class jobs too. When both the U.S. productive economy and wages were growing, there was little need to emphasize the economic benefits of higher education precisely because they were guaranteed. When the education premium is steadily rising, after all, it does not indeed matter much whether some students get degrees in art history and others in engineering. A rising tide lifts the boats of all those lucky enough to be in a boat in the first place. The human capital theory of the 40s and 50s thus both contributed and responded to the rise of a middle-class technocracy and to global economic changes. And yet there is no doubt that it was nowhere near as ubiquitous a discourse then as it has been in the 21st century university. Why? In the case of the university in particular, the answer I propose is paradoxical. Whereas it was possible to conceal the university's primarily economic function in a period of rising tides, it has been much less possible to do so in a period of falling fortunes. That is, human capital theory must assert itself more loudly in a moment in which its optimism about the economic benefits of education is significantly less justified. The education premium predictably rose to its highest level in the post-war decade, as it did again in the 1980s as the economy changed to accommodate the microelectronic revolution. But between 2001 and 2013, the average wage for workers with a bachelor's degree declined 10%. The current unemployment rate among recent college graduates is nearly identical to the national average rate of unemployment. Of those fortunate enough to have a job, half of university graduates have jobs that do not require a college degree. Because this is happening at the same time that college costs have increased many times faster than the rate of inflation, and given the cost of paying off student debt, by one estimate, 25% of U.S. universities now offer students a negative return on investment. As a result, today half of total student loan balances are not even in repayment. Some are in deferment, but a third of all outstanding student loans are delinquent. For many students today, then, human capital is a rather dire form of speculation indeed. What this history reveals, I think, is that for at least the last 60 years, the university has been tasked with training future workers according to the changing needs of capital. What has changed is thus not so much the soul of the university, but rather the needs of capital, which appears today to barely require workers at all. And this, in turn, means that human capital discourse has become desperately louder, not because the university is becoming more economic, but because it is becoming much less successful at guaranteeing positive economic outcomes for its graduates. Precisely because the university is increasingly disconnected from the economy as a whole, because it is increasingly irrelevant to or superfluous within an economy that now needs fewer educated workers than ever before, the language of human capital and economic outcomes has emerged as a kind of defense mechanism against the potentially very frightening political consequences of this reality. This particular way of approaching the rise of human capital discourse, noting that it comes into dominance at the very moment the human capital theory of education seems less apt than ever before, is a way of returning to the argument I made in my introduction. That is, sorry, this is a little bit complicated, but hopefully it makes sense. If the production of neoliberal thought by Hayek et al. In the 1940s lags significantly behind its uptake as the dominant ideology sometime around the 1980s, despite the fact that the threat of socialism that occasioned it in the 40s was no longer viable by the 80s, and if, similarly, the production of human capital theory in the 1950s and 60s was a response to a set of economic conditions around return on investment in education that also no longer applied by the time it was taken up as the master language of universities sometime in the 21st century, then we must think a bit harder about the cause-effect relationship between discourse on the one hand and historical and material conditions on the other. The question that remains, however, is what kind of subjects are produced out of those relations. To answer that, we must turn from human capital into the second figure of neoliberal subjectivity I mentioned before, namely the entrepreneur of the self. The entrepreneur of the self becomes unbanked. The cultural theories of neoliberal subjectivity cited earlier tend to claim, as I have already suggested, that the fantasy of entrepreneurial selfhood offers a kind of compensation for the depredations of contemporary political and economic life. Calculating every action according to a calculus of self-investment, the entrepreneur becomes a model for both the self and for sociability. Thus, Jason Reed writes that under neoliberalism, quote, everything for which human beings attempt to realize their ends, from marriage to expenditures on children, can be understood economically according to a particular calculation of cost for benefit. The way in which this entrepreneurial sensibility pervades every aspect of daily life is often described feelingly by critics of neoliberalism. It is Brown who offers perhaps the most uncannily familiar account of this condition, and so I will quote her at length. Quote, neoliberalism interpolates us as subjects who think and act like contemporary market subjects, even when, for example, approaching one's education, health, fitness, family life, or neighborhood. Thus, one might approach one's dating life in the mode of an entrepreneur or investor, or a student might undertake charitable service to enrich her college application profile. Similarly, a parent might choose a primary school for a child based on its placement rates in secondary schools who have high placement rates in elite colleges. The resulting, quote, figure of the human as an ensemble of entrepreneurial and investment capital is evident on every college and job application, every package of study strategies, every internship, every new exercise and diet program. The best university scholars are characters as entrepreneurial, whoops, I don't know what happened to that quote, but are entrepreneurial and investment savvy. Tasked with sole responsibility for her own subsistence, then, the neoliberal subject is recast as a cruelly optimistic entrepreneurial subject who can still at least conceive of herself as a manager of a portfolio of capital conducts and choices. But who, then, is this present subject who still had something to lose under neoliberalism, to whom the reduction of all choices to nothing more than money came as a surprise? Who is this entrepreneur of herself still trying to believe in a good life under capitalism? I suspect, alas, that precisely the recognition I just now described tells us the answer. It's us, white, educated, upper-middle-class citizens of the developed world. Partly what I'm trying to say is that this test, like if you think about the examples that she offers here, this becomes fairly obvious. Indeed, given the history of human capital theory I developed earlier, it may be us even more specifically, the professoriate protected from economic exigency even in the conditions of our employment, free to imagine that conditions of our labor were once non-economic. I don't mean to gainsay the usefulness of thinking about this subject who suddenly faces her embeddedness in economic life in ways that seem both new and newly alienating. In fact, I think describing what has happened to what we once called the professional managerial class is urgently important. And indeed, that's what I attempted to do earlier by talking about the university as a now decommissioned factory for producing the post-war PMC. But I still worry that entrepreneurialism and investment are not the best ways to describe the experience or the consciousness or the actual material status of what I would take to be the exemplary subject of the present. An underemployed part-timer, probably working in the service sector, buying her groceries on her credit card, cashing her paychecks at a check-cashing service, renting rather than owning her home, barely able to survive day to day, and unlikely to see any of this precarity as an interest-bearing investment in her future, nor to have much faith in the good life. This is not to say that nothing has changed for this particular homo economicus in the last few decades. Indeed, she's more likely to be underemployed than ever before because US capitalism has outsourced most of its productive labor to the developing world. She's relying more on credit than on the wage because of the power of the financial sector, happy to reap profits from her subprime debt. She's underpaid because the profitability of the service economy depends on the low cost of labor. These are important shifts. But they aren't shifts driven primarily by a change in consciousness or conduct, nor are they shifts we can really understand without offering a more economic periodization. And they also aren't shifts defined by the becoming economic of something formerly non-economic. Even before these new forms of intensified immiseration, the neoliberal subject was still an exploited wage worker. Her role in the credit economy was still based on a form of exclusion, since she was, if she was a woman or black or poor, 40 years ago she wouldn't have been able to get a loan at all. She was still in an economy in which basic human subsistence depended on the property relation. If she was non-white, she was probably excluded from many of the government programs that built post-war middle-class prosperity. In other words, I want to suggest that insofar as we are attempting to locate and describe the qualitative and also quantitatively exemplary subject of our present, we might do well to think less about portfolios and dividends and more about categories like, for instance, the condition of being un- and underbanked. According to the FDIC, as of 2015, 10 million households in the US were unbanked, largely because of immigration status, credit record, low income, or simply because they were located in one of the 1,000 banking deserts that are becoming more common across the US as a result of bank consolidation and housing segregation. If you include the category of underbanked, meaning households that use conventional banks but also payday loans, pawn shops, and check cashing services, the number grows exponentially. 30% of the nation's household are either un- or underbanked, with that number rising to 50% of Black and Latino households. The average payday loan, a short-term, high-interest loan typically secured by a borrower's future paycheck, requires a repayment of $400 within 2 weeks, while the average borrower can only afford $50. Do those who take out payday loans understand themselves as canny investors in themselves, optimistic, even if cruelly, that they will have the $400 once the bill comes due? Not surprisingly, studies suggest otherwise. According to one recent report, the most common answer for why borrowers took out loans they knew they weren't going to be able to repay was pure desperation. Quote, more than one-third of borrowers say they have been in such a difficult situation that they would take a payday loan on literally any terms offered. This example is a particularly resonant one for me because I recently finished a book precisely about the consequences of credit and debt on everyday life. It's a book that makes big claims about the historical effects of particular forms of consumer debt, bank-based credit cards, mortgages, and student loans. A full 2 chapters of the book were dedicated to housing as a key site of what Randy Martin influentially termed the financialization of everyday life. They were especially concerned with the violence and the suffering caused by eviction and foreclosure on those who could no longer pay their mortgages. Just as my final MS went out to the press, however, a book on a related topic was published that I eagerly sought out, Matthew Desmond's Evicted, Poverty and Profit in the American City, which happened to not only be all about eviction, which I had just written a lot about, but also to take place in Milwaukee, where I lived at the time and where I had lived while I wrote most of the book. But whereas my book was largely about home ownership, about mortgages as a distinct form of alienation, and about the ideas of property that underwrite them, Desmond's book was about a different kind of eviction and a different kind of property dispossession, namely the eviction of renters. Even having written 100 pages about eviction, I thus found myself shocked by Desmond's book and dismayed as I realized what I had overlooked because of my focus on homeowner evictions and mortgages. In a 2-year period between 2009 and 2011, the very years I was writing most about, a quarter of the moves undertaken by the poor in Milwaukee were involuntary. 25% of the moves, all moves, were involuntary. New York City courts saw almost 80 non-payment renter evictions a day in 2009 and 2010, while as of 2015, 1 of 9 occupied rental units in Cleveland and Chicago have been summoned to eviction. Over the course of the 5 years I spent writing about mortgages and homeowner evictions, a period in which I myself became a homeowner, I detail I think is not incidental to the terms of my intellectual focus, literally hundreds of thousands of renter evictions took place all over my own city while barely making it into my book. What would it mean, I want to ask, for us to situate these political subjects at the center of our analysis, to think about the, quote, financialization of everyday life or the application of economic reasoning, precisely by thinking about subjects unlikely to ever see themselves as entrepreneurs and equally unlikely to be seen by others as a viable source of human capital? It would certainly force us to think a bit more before we describe the present moment as one in which, as if for the first time, everything for which human beings attempt to realize their ends can be understood economically according to a particular calculation of cost for benefit. That's that quote up there. For one thing, we would have to note that for millions of people across the US, to say nothing of globally, the realization of ends has always already been economic. And we would have to think about the ways in which this is not the effect of a set of beliefs, theirs or capital's. Here again, for instance, I'm inclined to be the tedious person in the room who suggests we reread Marx, especially the chapter on the working day, which describes the experience singular to the form of capitalism in which labor, and thus the time of daily life, is organized via wages, in which the very question of when one's day begins and ends, whether one does or doesn't eat a meal, whether one can or cannot attend Sunday Mass, becomes an intimately economic question. Again, I am not suggesting that nothing has changed since Marx's 19th century. Rather, what I am saying is that at least three things central to my argument have changed, but they don't have much to do with entrepreneurial subjectivity. First, more and more people are finding themselves both permanently and newly in the class of people for whom everything, even and especially the sphere of reproductive life, housing, healthcare, education, and childcare, is profoundly economic, precisely insofar as it is uncertain, precarious, and without guarantee. That is, those in the borderline middle class, as well as young people from the lower all the way up to the upper middle class, those who live in formerly industrialized zones of the North and Midwest, or in the formerly vibrant extractive and agricultural economies of the South, those in certain sectors of the professional managerial class, the growing non-tenure track professoriate, for instance, are finding their lives more and more similar to the conditions in which the marginally employed, the working poor, immigrants, and people of color have long had to survive. Second, and as a result, a growing percentage of the population of the developed world are finding themselves not entrepreneurs of the self, but rather pure surplus. Populations whose bare reproduction, however minimal, is no longer worth capital's investment. They are not the population Marx identified as a, quote, industrial reserve army of the unemployed, a population that must exist in a constant state of readiness toward the moment when capital might reabsorb them into the productive population. Rather, they are what Marx described elsewhere as, quote, a consolidated surplus population whose misery is in inverse ratio to the amount of torture it has to undergo in the form of labor. They are excluded, that is, even from the process of exploitation itself. Redundant to the needs of capital, always already radically unabsorbable by it, they are punitively contained in ghettos, camps, and prisons. They are the involuntarily mobile of cities like Milwaukee, the massive and growing homeless population of urban areas like LA, the global population of the imprisoned, of which 25% live in the US. This class could not look less like the potential form of human capital describable as, quote, at once the business, the raw material, the product, the clientele, and the customer of their own life, a jumble of assets to be invested, managed, and developed. Instead, they exist in a condition of social death, ineligible for humanity, let alone human capital, a surplus population that exists to be contained, not credited, to be exported, not exploited, to be annihilated, not invested in. This brings me then to the third thing that has changed, or perhaps to a change that is not a change. That is, far from being marked by what Brown terms soft rather than hard power, far from being a phenomenon that has primarily, quote, taken root in subjects and in language, in ordinary practices and consciousness, the present moment in no way suggests a shift from direct physical coercion to more ideological forms of self-discipline. Rather, history has arced in the opposite direction. In the book, I make this case by exploring the means for collecting and managing debt in the wake of the crisis of 2008. Contrary to Lazzarato's argument that neoliberal debt deploys subjectivity and ideology as a means of exploiting debtors' sense of morality, in fact, the growing threat of imprisonment as punishment evidences the extraordinarily coercive and material power that creditors have been able to exert over working class and poor debtors in the contemporary era. And in fact, if you trace like the sort of history of like credit law and laws around credit collection, you see this, that in fact, it looks much more like the sort of condition of the United States before the abolition of debt prisons, so that rather than moving from coercion into ideology, it's actually going backwards. Credit collectors and eviction agents today break down doors in the middle of the night. They come in with fully armed SWAT teams. The population destined by birth to lives of social death are even more explicitly managed and disciplined with a violence little concerned by the likelihood of their destruction, from the segregation or exclusion of basic services like housing and healthcare to subjection to police violence and prison. Contemporary surplus populations are not the, quote, docile and productive bodies managed by, quote, the engineers of consciousness and individuality that Foucault argued run the modern prison, but rather are destined for what Loic-Picant terms brute neutralization, rote retribution, and simple warehousing. For these reasons, then, I'm suggesting that if we want to be able to locate, understand, and describe the subjects most qualitatively and quantitatively specific to the present conjuncture, we ought not rest so easy in terms like human capital and entrepreneur. Better, I think, might be terms like precarious, dispossessed, criminalized, surplus population, socially dead. And yet, despite the balefulness of these descriptions, I do not see this as a purely negative claim. That is, to suggest that contemporary political and economic life are arranged according to a logic of exclusion from the economy rather than subsumption in it, and to suggest in turn that such exclusions are managed via coercive material violence rather than subjectivity, ideology, and mystification, is also to suggest that many of the subjects of the present know full well the conditions of the world in which they live. To understand what I mean here, I want to return to the group I know the best, namely students. The condition of the indebted student is, as I have suggested, often taken to be the best example of cruel optimism. Here, the belief that massive educational debt is worthwhile as an entrepreneurial investment in one's future. Certainly, these students have been told that education debt is good because it will inevitably lead to higher incomes and a better life, a language that attempts to solicit what Berlant describes as the kinds of conventional good life fantasies that we cling to even when they betray us. And yet my own experience discussing debt with my former students at University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee has suggested anything but optimism, cruel or otherwise. UWM is an open admission institution in Wisconsin's urban center. The city of Milwaukee, along with the state as a whole, has struggled to survive amidst the depredations of deindustrialization and post-industrial transformations of the farming economy. My students came from urban Milwaukee, rural northern Wisconsin, and the highest poverty suburban communities in the state. It came from working and middle-class families, and many saw, through their parents, the dire consequences of subprime debt and foreclosure. In addition to their parents' housing debts, these students are burdened with their own student loan and credit card debt. Many are first-generation college students, their retention and graduation rates are relatively low, while their average time to degree is unusually long. All of them work, and most of them work full-time. Many are supporting not only themselves, but also their families. They work in a range of jobs exemplary of a deindustrialized circulation and reproduction economy. Truck drivers, baristas, line cooks, pizza deliverers, bartenders, retail salespeople, IT helpline staffers, daycare workers, warehouse stockers. They are working hard for their degrees, even as those degrees are delayed by so much work. All of this, so much work and so many years for an increasingly devalued degree, may well sound cruelly optimistic. But that is not, in fact, what these students are. These students turn out to have a very different, far darker but more productive view of all those cruel reassurances about debt, that it is investment in the future, that it is a measure of moral obligation. Today's student debtors are not in the least optimistic. Rather, they possess a demystified, canny, and finally radical kind of knowledge. They do not believe in a future good life of financial security and middle-class mobility. They do not believe they will own homes like their parents do. They do not believe they will move up the ladder of social mobility. They do not have faith that they will find meaningful, much less stable work. Indeed, many of them assume they will be working the same jobs after they graduate that they're working now. They see themselves not as human capital, but rather as permanently indebted. In this sense, I am suggesting student debtors are effectively connected less to the managerial professoriate and more to the radically dispossessed surplus populations I described earlier. For this reason, I see in them a much different, more radical, less knowing, more radical, less optimistic, more knowing form of political subjectivity than most theories of neoliberalism allow. This is also to say that I think we should be wary of subscribing to what I previously suggested we might term the Walter Ben Michaels critique of neoliberal individualism, I cited above, whereby all references to individual desire, motive, belief, and experience are disqualified as irrelevant mystifications or political withdrawals. The abstract and the universal do not lie apart from the concrete and the particular. Rather, the unemployed and the underemployed, subprime debtors and pawn shop borrowers, victims of police violence and the incarcerated class, all are able to glimpse the mechanisms, the motions, and also the limits of the political and economic totality which subsumes them. They are at once the products of that totality and the subjects most capable of reckoning with it. Theirs is a knowledge that comes from seeing your parents struggle to maintain their class position, from seeing your aunts and uncles evicted, from seeing your neighbors lose their jobs due to deindustrialization and outsourcing, from seeing your cousins and friends beaten or killed by cops. New historical conditions produce new modes of historical consciousness, new ways to grapple with history as it happens. The political power of such subjects may find expression as collective agency in anti-police riots and university occupations, or it may find expression as sheer historical exigency in the housing and student debt and unemployment crises to come. In either case, we see how political subjectivity, what we think, what we feel, what we believe, is still inextricable from political action. No one has put this point more finely than Chris Nealon. The volatility born of the contradictions in Capital might better point to a different, earlier understanding of theory, not the pursuit of a transcendental vantage point or the critique of that pursuit, but the relentless surveying of possible grounds for solidarity amongst those for whom the regime of Capital only spells suffering. In our contemporary capitalist landscape, a survey of the grounds for solidarity shows us the shared interests of defaulted students and payday borrowers, of the unemployed and the incarcerated. For these solidarities to come into view, we need to know that what unites us today is not the good life fantasy of entrepreneurial ambition and self-appreciation, but the universal knowledge of that fantasy's historical end. Thanks.
We have 20 or 25 minutes for our questions.
Great. Lucky me.
I wanted to ask you, given that this was a great talk, I really enjoyed this, and I want to get to the biography afterwards, and if you know, we read all of this, you know, I will learn a lot about the topic for sure, so it's very helpful to see all the references. Given that we were so focused on the neoliberal subject, I wanted to ask you about a sort of tension between or shifting between the singular and the plural in your talk. So as a neoliberal student, but then we also talk about students. And so the question of various forms of collectivities for me, it comes up especially towards the end of the talk. And I was thinking this partly came to me because of the reference to Wendy Brown. You know, when she's talking about neoliberalism, the title of that book is Undoing the Demons, right? And so a lot of what's going on in that book has to do with neoliberalism's destruction and what she calls, I think, mostly aspiring popular sovereignty in that book. So I'm thinking if we ask the question of possible forms of collective life, different kinds of collectivities that could come out of this situation which you lay out by focusing on this subject in this particular talk, what kind of collectivities are you imagining? Is the term popular sovereignty meaningful still for you in the context? Where would you go with that sort of question of the plural in this context and forms of political organization?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. That's a hard question. I mean, I guess I think that it still looks a bit like class in the sense that it's collectivities produced out of a set of historical conditions and collectivities imaginable and meaningful insofar as they are in emphatic historical contradiction with other groups in the way that classes are in Marx's account. And except, of course, that the content of what we would take to be some sort of equivalent to the proletariat is not the same content, right? I mean, one of the things that I'm trying to do is trying to use the ways that, like Marxist feminist theory from the 1970s, 80s, 90s, I'm thinking here particularly of people like Silvia Federici, have used talking about primitive accumulation and the sort of very early moments of capitalism to expand our sense of who the dispossessed of capital are. And including in that analysis, among other things, a sort of lumpen proletariat and workers in the sort of so-called reproductive spheres, the unproductive, so-called unproductive spheres of the sort of capital circuit. So, you know, whether that's women's domestic work or work in education or work in those domains of social life that sort of appear exterior to capital but of course never work. Which is to say it's not the industrial working class, right? It's a broader population that is produced out of the set of historical conditions but not the same as the one that Marx imagined in the 19th century. It's one where you, rather than seeing for Marx, right, the industrial reserve army, like their interests are misaligned to the interests of the working class because they want to become members of the working class and they're used as a threat to keep the working class in check, essentially. right? And so I think that one of the things that I'm trying to describe in thinking about, say, surplus populations is the ways in which those populations are so radically excluded from capitalism that they might actually, their interests might actually align with the interests of other classes excluded in different ways, whether that's excluded from conventional credit, excluded from employment, excluded from stable or full-time employment, et cetera. So just trying to sort of broaden the sense of what a class might look like. And the consequence of that, I suspect, is that it also means that the forms of struggle won't look like they did when the class was an industrial working class, right? So I'm not thinking about unions, and I'm not even necessarily thinking about political parties. I'm thinking about something that has a more sort of horizontal makeup, and I think if you look at the sort of protest movements in the United States in the last 10 years, that is, in fact, what they look like.
Thank you. This was a really great talk. I'm going to venture a question, but this is not totally formulated. I self-interestedly want to return to your initial beginning point where you're talking, where you graph the historical discontinuity between the opposition to communism and then and then the growth of the hegemony of neoliberalism at its demise. And I'm wondering around, like, sort of building on this discussion of sort of a new kind of class-based analysis and a new re-examination of the proletariat, is some of this realignment built on ideological opposition to this notion of the demise of the entrepreneur, or in what ways is it tied to the fall of communism as as in terms of its ideological mobilization? So if to a certain extent the reformulation of a different kind of class consciousness has to mobilize around a different kind of ideology that's not the proletariat. Hmm. What's its relationship then in turn to, or is there a relationship?
That's really interesting. That had honestly never even occurred to me. That's an interesting question. I suspect I would say no, partly because sort of the point of what I'm saying, if I had to like boil it down, is sort of that, I mean, again, I'm going to be really vulgar, is that that ideological superstructures are the product of an economic base, right? So then I would say that those changes in the ways that political positionality or affiliation is imagined would have to themselves emerge out of economic conditions rather than out of another set of ideological conditions, right? So that it's not like a battle of one idea against another, exactly. I mean, it may become that way. Yeah. But I think that's an interesting question. I mean, the thing about the sort of the gap in the uptake is just, something that I've been thinking about the question of how do you periodize it and stuff, and also just trying to get a grasp on what the relationship is between the ways that we talk about this in the present and what those scholars actually wrote. And I think in really interesting ways, actually, this last day and a half has really helped me start to think about that in slightly clearer terms. I think I have a little bit of a better sense, but I'm just interested in why is it that almost nobody would say neoliberalism begins in the 40s, when you're talking about as a period, mm-hmm. right? And so that's the other thing, I'm just trying to sort of suss out what's the difference between the way that it's described in the Mont Pelerin volume, for instance, as a set of practices, ideas, beliefs, philosophy, essentially, mm-hmm. and then the way that it seems to be getting used in cultural studies in the present, which is as a period, right, a historical period, and mm-hmm. as something that thus sort of includes and subsumes all aspects of economic and political life, right? And that's the part that I'm a bit more skeptical about, and so I'm skeptical about the idea that it subsumes it for the reasons that I'm suggesting. I think that actually many people don't see themselves in those terms at all. But I'm also just sort of wondering, how would that come to be? Right? How would those ideas become dominant in this period, and why? And there, I do think that you have to understand them as the response to sort of a particularly canny response to a set of economic conditions that necessitated such a reimagination of the sort of structure of the regulation of the market in the sort of fall of the post-war boom of the 50s and 60s. Yeah, Chris.
Thanks for that, and nice to have the class analysis back in the room. And but I wanted to, I have sort of two questions, maybe I'll just ask one. And that is, there are studies of the proletariat or the surplus population excluded by class. I mean, some of the cultural studies analyses of The Wire, for example, mm-hmm. that sort of want to extend you know, this model into that set of the population. And a case I know more about, you know, in the Chinese working class, in the migrant labor population, especially of women, mm-hmm. You know, there's one of the difficulties that labor organizers, activists face is a kind of pervasiveness of an entrepreneurialism of the self mm-hmm. among the workers that they get through self-help books and these kind of things. And as far as I know, this isn't absent in this country. I mean, in these populations, in other words, the you know, not always books, but various programs and orientations along these lines. So I wonder if there's a kind of empirical, you know, if there's a way to kind of make this call, you know, when it seems to me that there's some, mm-hmm. you know, that there's not a little bit of evidence on the other side too.
Yeah, no, it's hard. And I mean, it's, you know, it's purely, it's totally interpretive, right? And at best it relies on anecdata. I'm not saying that like those things don't exist. And I also, I mean, I think the thing that I'm saying, and this is kind of like, gets me out of this problem in a way, so it's going to seem kind of like shifty, but I think this is something that's happening fast and now, and that it's maybe something that we just haven't fully caught up with yet. But I'll give you, I mean, the best example that I know that where there is actually some data, I think that this study about payday loans is useful, for one thing. But the other example is that they've done, you know, sort of behavioral economists have started doing a lot of research about student debtors and student debtors' attitudes towards debt, partly because they're interested because this is such a radically fast generational shift, right? So the difference between student debtors graduating right now and their parents in terms of their the amount of debt that they're undertaking and the sort of conditions of the debt is just astronomical, right? It's a very fast shift to happen in a single generation. And so they're studying their relationships to that debt, and they're comparing their sort of effective responses to the debt to the effective responses of students from like 10 years before. And they're finding, and they're quite concerned, that students today are significantly less likely to understand their debt as a moral obligation, as something that they have to repay, and significantly more likely to be willing to see it, A, as a kind of, I mean, I use the phrase odious debt, drawing on the sort of the term that's used by like anti-national debt movements. So that they're significantly more likely to see it as a form of odious debt. They're significantly less likely to think of it as something that they have an obligation to repay. They're significantly more likely to say that if there was any way they could get out of it, they would. In fact, there was this study done that was about like asking students all these very silly questions about like, would you eat burnt toast for 3 years to get rid of your student debt? Or would you serve as Donald Trump's butler for a year to get rid of your student debt? But more distressingly, 50% of students said that they would join the military to get rid of their student debt. And the average number of years that they would reduce their lives to get rid of it was 4. And so I think that like, you know, if you look at those studies and you think about the way that they're thinking about their debt, that is like one place where there is at least a little bit of it. But otherwise, I'm just guessing. Yeah.
Just sort of, I mean, one sort of follow-up suggestion based on that, how fast would this be? You know, there was a lot of like pulling data during the Bush era, which mm-hmm. was kind of like the height of this pollution society mantra about how millionaires were off, still favored high taxes, projecting that once yeah. in the future they were. And so that would just be, I mean, it would be interesting to see where those numbers are at now.
They're lower. They're still higher. I looked at them actually when I was prepping for this. They're lower. They're still higher than they are in most other countries, but they're significantly lower than they were during the Bush years. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's interesting. My question is sort of just about, this is a very basic question, but it seems like the scope of this talk suggests that we should think about retaining this idea of the entrepreneurial self, this thinking about individual freedom as a way that people make sense of things for people that are already well off. So it's a way for them to kind of rationalize how others are in situations they're not, while also theorizing themselves as somehow relatively free. Is that probably fair?
Yeah, well, I think actually it's not about so much about a confidence or a sense of stability. It's actually about an anxiety, right? I mean, it's not as, I mean, you know, and there, this is where I'm trying to connect it up to the sort of critique of that position, right? Is that I think it's an expression of a legitimate anxiety about the class position of the professional managerial class or the upper middle class, which is accurate. There is a lot to be anxious about. So I'm just sort of suggesting that, like, you know, it's a useful term. It's a term that describes something. It's definitely a term that describes the ways that institutions talk about people. But I don't think it describes the way that institutions talk about all people. And I also don't think that it necessarily is so evident in the ways that people understand their own relationship to economic life, either because they have understood full well that all of the decisions that they make were always already economic, or because they have no confidence that what they're doing will produce a set of economic outcomes that are positive, and rather they're acting under a set of sort of sheer material necessity, right? Desperation of kind.
One question, but I think we can do that. But I do have some data and some anecdotes about. I teach at Rutgers New York, which is the most diverse campus in America, where more than 80% of the students are alone, are students. It is not even a predominantly middle class campus. It's actually more working class, very large Black and Latino population. Also, I just learned about more than 10% of the students are Muslims. So given that background, right, and we're just reeling from what's going to happen with the next project. Also called an urban campus, right? What's interesting about those students, I found in the last 9 years of teaching there, is on the one hand that they would understand the latter half of your talk, right? Having said that, I think it's also interesting, and I think worth keeping in mind, that the self-imagination that here is being presented as the imagination of the neoliberal subject, but I think it's just one element of the self-imagination of the contemporary subject, right? You could probably find fissured along where those students are located, even in the institution. Mm-hmm. So for instance, the self, the entrepreneurial subject, I have business school students, and for some reason, the Trump supporters have decided that they can talk to me because I don't immediately dismiss them, right? So I can touch them. But what I find, and it's not even divided along racial lines, right? It is really, I'm going to have a lot of business school students because I teach in the honors college and they have to take certain honors courses. And the business school students do tend to actually think in precisely those languages, no matter what their class background. And then some of the others, it'll depend on where they're located, right? So I think that what we're talking about is a political imagination, and what we're also talking about is how that political imagination is actually distributed, even up within the class that you're talking about, depending on its aspirational structure. So maybe we want to talk a little bit,
Absolutely. No, and I think that's really useful. And I think, I guess what I would say is that, like, and I talk about this a little bit in the book as well, is that, like, I really want to think about, like, two sort of, like, very related but distinct forms of political transformation, right? One is political transformation that's driven by the political organizing of collective groups working to fight these kinds of things, right? So groups strike debt and groups trying to stop student debt or not pay it or whatever, right? And so those kinds of formations do depend in some part on consciousness. But there's another set of possibilities for political transformation, which is simply historical conditions, right? And that, like, if the point about the statistic about the fact that, like, a third of student loans are currently in default is to say that even without a movement organized to stop paying our loans, we're not paying our loans, right? So to sort of think about, like, I'm trying on the one hand, not to refuse all conversations about subjectivity in the way that I think that sort of Ben Michaelsian critique does, right? Which is that, like, anytime you talk about someone's experience or their motives or their desires or beliefs, you're sort of ideologically mystified and you should just be talking about the class as a sort of historical, as a sort of magical product of history, right? So I don't want to sort of dismiss concern, a sort of attempt to describe a set of affective and subjective conditions. At the same time, it's not reducible to that either, right? Because the thing is that, like, those business students, like, the question is, like, for whom would they be understood as human capital if in fact they can't even get jobs, right?
No, I understand that. All I was saying was that there's what I heard, and I could be wrong here,
yeah,
was that there was a claim being made here about the political imagination.
Yeah.
But it wasn't clear what that, the relation of that claim was to the economic conditions, right? Because what it sounded like for a moment was these cultural theorists, and I have no residual investment or any investment in Walter Benjamin-Michaels,
right,
is that they've just got the imagination wrong, right?
Yeah.
And my point is that it's got to be more, it sounds more complicated than that. The Trump supporter, for instance, who I've been having very long conversations with this semester, may have some form of false consciousness, is not what I'm arguing, right?
Yeah.
But the question is, if there's an account of political imagination,
right,
then that political imagination may line up in very odd ways with the current economic conditions.
Yeah.
But that relationship needs a little bit more of a nuanced account, that's all I'm saying.
Right, yeah. I think I'm just trying to add to that existing account of the ways that subjectivity is conceived in the present and suggest that it leaves something out. And then I think it's symptomatic that if you look at the people that are writing about higher, like sort of neoliberalization of higher education as it affects students' perspectives, I'm not talking in terms of institutions, but as it affects students' perspectives of their education, that an awful lot of those people are writing from the position of being at elite institutions.
Yeah.
And I think that if we're looking at higher education exclusively from the perspective of elite institutions, we're missing most of it, right? We're missing that half of my students and that half of your students who see things in a radically different way, right? Maybe we're describing the other half okay, though we're still, as you said, right, we're not describing what actually happens to them no matter what they think or feel once they get out of the labor market, right? So we're failing to describe the material conditions, and we're failing to describe some fair portion of the sort of subjective or aspirational experience of those students.
It's more of a comment. When I was finishing my PhD and desperately hunting for a job, I got a one-year job at the University of Minnesota, but I was going to try to switch to business, try to do something. And at that Department of Economics, I thought maybe I should study some economics. So the Department of Economics, the mass market class on sort of macro was taught by this guy whose name is probably not the number of any people in this room, named Walter Heller, who was one of the chief economic advisors to President Kennedy, I think, who had a notion that that the government could fix the economy by making some particular changes. But the graduate students that we had graduate students were all taking classes from the exciting theoretical people. There was other theory other than literary theory in this sort of thing. and the theory that was being developed was called rational expectations. And that's one of the things that happens alongside Mount Tolerance Society. So I suppose might be worth taking a look at the rational expectations, but it might be disturbing to see it, because among one of the famous articles by Robert Lucas, who was Nobel Prize winner in Chicago, was an article that said, we really misunderstand the Depression. The Depression was caused by people who chose not to work. So it really wasn't the way people think it is. And that would seem probably terribly cruel, but nonetheless. But thinking about that theorizing.
Absolutely. No, I mean, I have the fellowship next year to do a year and a half of economics coursework full time, so yeah, to write this other book. So that's exactly the kind of stuff that I want to work on. So yeah, it's a good, great suggestion. Thank you.
But there's no way out of this. If you flip the Lucas article, it isn't that people chose not to get jobs. They couldn't get jobs. And,
I'm sorry, I have to be the night watchman in this state. Because the police will be at the door at a certain moment. So please...
Thank you.